watching Capitol Report with Senator John DeFrancisco. I'm Julie Locandy. Today, the Senator and I are going to talk about saving taxpayers' money. How are you, Senator?
It's a great thing to do.
Yes, it is. So there's some new methods going around. I want to start off with talking to you about pension reform. The governor says that he has a new plan to save the state millions of dollars by reforming the pension system. Tell us.
Well, basically what he's saying is that we've got the problem with pension reforms and the cost to local governments and the cost to the state is that pensions get vested. Once you're vested, you are entitled to a specific payout depending upon your years of service and your salary. In order to really affect the system, you got to start with a new class of pensioners. Right now, last year or the year before, we passed Tier 5, which has more requirements in it before you're entitled to a pension, more time in, more contributions by the employee to make the cost of the state or the local government less. And what the governor came out with yesterday was a plan for a Tier 6, which means that you can't, in this tier, if it's passed, you can't retire till you're 65. There's more contributions that are required by the employee, and as a result, the cost to the state and the local governments would be less because there's more employee contribution. So this is what he said he was going to do in his campaign, and so he hasn't submitted the actual bill yet, but that's what he announced yesterday.
Okay. A recent Marist College poll found that 1 in 3 New Yorkers hightail it right out of New York that are under the age of 30, while 1 in 4 above that leave in about 5 years. And according to the survey, it says that these people are attributing their decision to the cost of living and taxes.
You know, that number surprised me. I knew it was high. I didn't realize it was that high. And if that isn't an affirmation of what we were trying to do in the last few budgets, when we were arguing against the increased spending and the increased taxes for 2 years when the New York City Democrats controlled everything in 2009 and 2010, and the cutbacks to justify our cutbacks this year. There was a real movement in the Assembly and with some state senators from New York City to increase taxes. They call it a millionaire's tax, but the millionaire's tax that's in effect now affects anybody over $200,000, joint incomes, husband and wife. So every time you increase tax sends a message that it's less desirable to live here. And the argument always is, well, the millionaires have the money. Listen, people make their decisions. I don't care if you're a millionaire or not a millionaire. If you're planning a career and you're a young adult and you're starting your career, you want to make a lot of money, I would think. Most people don't object to it. Mm-hmm. The only people that object to it are those that haven't made a lot of money. And do you want entrepreneurs and individuals who are going to be successful? And you can't be successful if the tax structure is so out of whack. So this, I think, is an affirmation of our budget cuts this year, no new taxes, and I think we've turned the corner and we've got to keep in that direction.
Right. Actually, I want to go right now to a video of you and your Senate colleagues talking about why this budget needed to control spending and cut taxes.
Send a message to the business community that New York State is prepared to work with you, not stand in your way, the creation of jobs.
Now, one of the priorities that we had through this budget process was to remember that there are people out there that are in real need.
It's a time for serious consideration of the dire economic consequences faced by every tax-paying citizen of this state, every job producer of this state.
A month ago, a company by the name of Luminite, family-owned business that's been in the city of Salamanca for 85 years, decided to move out of New York State.
New York State has a spending problem. If we keep taxing, we're going to keep running people out of the state of New York.
And they said to us, you know what, we know some people in Albany like you and the governor are trying to change the business climate, but we can't take the heavy taxes anymore. We can't take the heavy regulations.
We have to work harder together to free up restrictions on businesses. The taxes and the fees that were issued the last 2 years were ridiculous.
We have no future in this state continuing to be number one in all the wrong ways. number one in killing jobs, number one in taxing.
That's what that side of the aisle, the Senate Democrats, have consistently done over the past 2 years. You raised 124 new taxes and fees.
124 new taxes.
To the tune of some $14 billion.
At a time when people could least afford it.
Not taking into account what the aftermath would be, as if we could go on forever.
When they had trouble paying their utility bills, you taxed them even more. When they had trouble paying their property taxes, you taxed them even more. When they had trouble paying their health insurance premiums, you taxed them even more. You tax their motor vehicle registrations.
In order to do something down the road, you have to make changes today.
Business as usual in state government has become unsustainable and unacceptable.
You can't keep on spending money that you don't have. The controller indicated over the last couple of years that level of spending was not sustainable.
We have a $10 billion deficit. We have to live in the real world.
We're not only tackling the deficit this year, but tackling the future deficits by not taxing, by creating the opportunity for job growth, cutting government waste, duplicative services.
With every challenge comes an opportunity to save dollars and also improve services for the people of New York.
Because it's sending a clear message to the people of the state and the people of this country that this heavy taxation will not continue.
Making money, hiring employees. The more employees, the more the tax base, the more the tax base, the less the burden on individuals.
We've got to turn the state around, and that's what this budget is about.
It's loud and clear that we're not imposing a new tax.
So something had to change, and you just had to make those decisions.
You know, that's a great clip because it shows the United Republican Conference from Long Island, upstate New York, central New York, western New York. Everybody is pulling in the same direction, and it was necessary in view of the damage that was done the last couple of years when taxes were increased by $14 billion and spending by $14 billion. So with Governor Cuomo, the new Republican majority, we took over the majority, was able to win that debate on the floor because we had the votes. You know, and a lot of people, they criticize legislators for not doing what they want done, but they got to have legislators that are consistent with their points of view. And I think what we're representing now in the state Senate and what the governor is representing, being more fiscally prudent to put the state back in a good fiscal shape, I think is what the people want, and we got to keep that momentum going.
Right. As we talked last week, the governor is going around the state. One thing he's rallying for is the support for the property tax cap. Has there been any progress since then?
Well, the assembly still hasn't put a bill in. You know, the assembly speaker keeps saying, we're going to put a bill in, we got a bill, we'll have some changes. You know, but it's the old ropey-dope that he's been playing for many, many years as speaker. He'll say one thing and then not do anything. And what's frustrated me, quite frankly, and I have a great working relationship with the governor, when he's going around the state saying the legislature has to pass the tax cap, he should be saying the assembly has to pass the tax cap. The Senate passed his identical bill. We didn't change a word, a comma, an exclamation point. We didn't change anything. And so we've done it. So we joined the governor. We want the assembly to put the governor's bill on. Don't water it down so there's 12 exceptions to make it useless. But get the bill on the floor and let's get a vote. Let's get it done.
Yeah, and the Senate passed it back in January.
It was our first bill beyond the budget. It was actually even before the budget. So we passed it very, very early, and the governor going around saying the legislature, the Senate did it, you know. So hopefully there'll be enough pressure on the assembly speaker to put it on the floor. He says he's going to do it. Do it.
Right. The governor's also hit the pavement to lobby for ethics reform to restore trust in government. He's saying things like, we need something that mandates transparency and disclosure since the legislature is a part-time gig, and an independent monitor so the legislature doesn't police itself. How do you feel?
Well, first of all, if you're going to be a crook and you don't have good moral character, you can pass whatever law you want to pass. It's not going to change the behavior of someone who is leaning or has the character that's going to do something like that. There are criminal laws on the books, and those people that fell astray All the legislators face the music as far as the courts are concerned, as far as the criminal courts. The only one who hasn't was the governor, Governor Spitzer. He violated the law. He resigned from office, and no one says about the ethics, his ethics violations, and the fact that he escaped criminal punishment. Why? That's an excellent question for another show. And there were several allegations against Governor Patterson. He survived that storm during the course of his tenure. There was never any charges brought against him. So that's number one. Number two, I have no problem disclosing whatever has to be disclosed. For example, if the law firm that I work with or a business that somebody else has does business with the state, that should be disclosed, and it ought to be disclosed. But if you're a lawyer and you represent, for example, people in, which I don't, but people having divorce cases or matrimonial matters, what is the business of the world? Why would they care who I'm representing in a case of personal nature like that? Second, it violates the confidences. You know, maybe just advising the person. Maybe they don't want to bring the lawsuit. Maybe they don't want to bring the action. So it's, I think the governor's original bill is a little overbroad, but he's moving back to the concept that I was just talking about, doing business with the state. As far as financial disclosure, you know, I'll disclose my outside income, but what does that tell you? Let's suppose I have a lot of outside income, and we disclose it now. There's categories. In fact, Senator Skelos sent out his financial disclosure form that's required now. Mm-hmm. So now they're going to have more categories, so you can see more specifically how much money somebody's making out. What does that tell you? Does that tell you if someone makes a lot of money outside of government that they've made it unethically, illegally? What does it matter if someone makes a little bit of money? Does that mean they're not as good at graft, or they're more susceptible to graft? I don't know the conclusion you draw. The issue is whether you're double dealing, whether you're doing business with the state or making money off the state that you can influence by way of your office. And those are the types of things that can disclose, and we can get an agreement on that.
Yeah, absolutely. The Senate leader, Senator Skelos, has said he's considering introducing ethics guides for the governor's office. So what do you think, in terms of ethics reform policies, what do you think would work?
I really think that you've got to have a firm set of rules that are real rules, not the rules that we have now. There's so many restrictions that you don't know when you're violating anything. If you have a cup of coffee and a donut at an event, there was a sign up at one of the events at the Library Association. Legislators could have a cup of coffee or a donut, not both, because that violates some ethics. It's as God is my witness. I wish I took a photograph of that sign before I had a coffee and donut, because I think it was so ridiculous, it's just beyond belief. But it's got to be honest, reasonable guidelines and an ability to enforce those guidelines. So if someone's in violation, they are going to pay a penalty. And other than simply the penalties provided in the criminal law if it's a criminal case.
So do you think there is going to be ethics reform, ethics legislation?
I really do. I really do. And I think that'll happen. But, you know, for the governor simply to say the legislature's corrupt, when the last two governors didn't do too good on ethical basis, on an ethical grounds. And I think it's got to apply to everybody. And I think it will have a bill. I really do.
And what is the speaker saying about this?
Nothing. He doesn't say anything until he has to. He's for ethics reform, but again, he doesn't exactly say what he's for and what he's against. Very nonspecific. He'll play ropey-dope again. Mm-hmm. Until the very end, and come out with a bill and try to negotiate the weakest possible ethics bill that he could negotiate.
And he's not comfortable disclosing his outside income.
He refuses to. He says, I'll follow the law as it exists.
Right. Okay. Thanks so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
For any additional information, you can log on to the Senator's website, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.